Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and his humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The servant of the Lord said, "The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, I did not turn backwards. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Please stand for the gospel.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What will you give me if I betray him to you?"
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus.
"Where do you want us to make the preparation for you to eat the Passover?"
"Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'"
So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me."
And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another,
"Surely, not I, Lord."
"The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to the one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
Judas, who betrayed him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said,
"Take, eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters because of me this night. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Though all become deserters, because of you, I will never desert you."
"Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And so said all the disciples. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet, not what I want, but what you want."
Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"So could you not stay awake with me for 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again he went away for the 2nd time and prayed,
"My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done."
Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the 3rd time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd, with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign.
The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him.
At once he came up to Jesus and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi,"
and kissed him.
"Friend, do what you are here to do."
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear.
"Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think I cannot appeal to my Father, and that he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last two came forward.
"This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.'"
The high priest stood up and said,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But Jesus was silent.
"I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God."
"You have said so. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?"
"He deserves death."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him.
"Prophesy to us, you Messiah. Who is it that struck you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said, "You were also well with Jesus, the Galilean." But he denied it before all of them.
"I do not know what you're talking about."
When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Again he denied it with an oath.
"I do not know the man."
After a while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
"Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you."
Then he began to curse and he swore an oath.
"I do not know the man."
At that moment the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor.
When Jesus, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders.
I have sinned by betraying innocent blood.
What is that to us? See to it yourself.
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said,
It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money.
After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what he had spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
You say so.
But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him,
Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?
But he gave no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So, after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word for him.
Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him.
Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
Which of the two do you want me to release for you?
Barabbas!
Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?
Let him be crucified.
Why? What evil has he done?
Let him be crucified.
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd.
I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves.
His blood be on us and on our children.
So he released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers and the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him.
Hail, King of the Jews!
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes amongst themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." Then two bandits who were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left, those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads.
"You would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him.
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'"
The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?"
That is, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"This man is calling for Elijah."
At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Then Jesus cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now, when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for them. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
"Sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive. 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' Therefore, command that the tomb be made secure until the 3rd day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and then tell the people he has been raised from the dead. And the last deception would be worse than the first."
"You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can."
So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone. This is the passion of the Lord.
Please be seated.
I remember once in a church in Italy seeing a painting on a wall, and it was of Palm Sunday, and you could see our Lord riding. He was riding onto majesty in the center, and around him the apostles, dignified men with beautiful faces, gathered around him. And all these children as well, lots and lots of children, and they're all going wild. They're waving their palm branches and olive branches as well. You've seen maybe in the Mediterranean they wave olive branches on Palm Sunday. And there's just one of them who's not paying attention there. It's one who's different. And you know what he's doing? He's having a look at the donkey, and he's giving him his palm branch, and he's saying to the donkey, as if he's saying to the donkey, "Oh, hello, donkey, look what I've got for you." So he's not paying attention. And I think the artist didn't put him there just to amuse us. He put him there to make a point. Because, as we've heard, the events of this week, we've just heard in this reading, dramatized wonderfully for us and by our readers, they're overwhelming, they're intense, they're dramatic, and it's easy to turn away. It's too intense, maybe. You can't sustain our attention like that little child. It's too much to go through it with Jesus. We turn away, maybe we come back on Easter morning. We tune out and we tune back in. But maybe that's not what our Lord asks of us. You remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, he says to the disciples, "Watch with me. Can you not watch with me 1 hour, 1 week of the year? Can you not go through this with me? Go through today the triumph, and tomorrow, soon, the betrayal and the abandonment and the soldiers coming after the agony in the garden, praying alone, left alone. Will we leave him alone?" And then the soldiers come, and the next day the crucifixion, the agony. And then, beyond that emptiness, Holy Saturday, that day of waiting, of emptiness. And then beyond, the great miracle. Can we watch with him? Can we go through that with him? Remember what he says when he sends the disciples ahead of him into the city to find the beast of burden he rides upon. If anyone asks you what you're doing, just say the Lord has need of it. Maybe the Lord has need of you this week to accompany him through these things, through the mysteries of March or mysteries of April this year, these mysteries every year of our redemption, of our salvation. The Lord has need of you. He trusts you with this responsibility to accompany him this Holy Week. Amen. So we kneel all seated for the prayers of penitence. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned, thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with a whole heart. We have not loved as ourselves. Your mercy, give what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
This week we hold before God in prayer the church. We pray for the Episcopal Church of South Sudan, Justin Bardi Arama, Archbishop and Bishop of Juba. We pray also for the church in Uppsala, Sweden, for Martin Modéus, Archbishop of Uppsala, and Karin Johansson, Bishop of Uppsala. Also for all in the Islington Deanery, for Tamsin Merchant, Area Dean, David Allen, Sub-Dean, and for the Deanery Synod, Gillian Courtnell, the Lay Chairman, and for Treasurer Folletti. We ask your blessing on the Capital Vision Confident Disciples, namely those who care for children day by day, especially all parents and carers in our congregation today. As always, we pray for Sarah, Bishop of London, Rob, our Bishop of Edmonton, John, our Archdeacon, and James, our Vicar. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we pray for the nations of the world, their leaders, and all those working in national government. Let your strong hand control the nations and cause them to long for your love to rule on the earth. We pray that you strengthen all those who strive after true brotherhood and who work for righteousness and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, we pray for those who suffer from natural disasters or war or terrorism, or those who are powerless or poor. May they find hope, help, healing and renewal. We especially give thanks for those who work for Mary's Meals and pray for their staff and all those whom they feed and help all over the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, you have taught us that we are members of one another, and what none of us lives but to himself alone. We thank you for the community of which we are part. We especially think of those who live in Gresham Close, Windmill Hill. And on the second day of April, we pray for our church wardens. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick. We hold before God all those whose names are on our prayer board and ask your blessing on all those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. Robert Gillibrand, Jay Goodman, Janet Mazzy, Jay Haywood, Irene Fuller, Stephen Taylor, Laura Cope, Dawn Cope, Tony Andrews, David Dowers, Helen Clark, Cara and Carissa Kwaku, Eleanor Pritchard, Alan F. Grave, Michael Dixon, Rowan O'Malley, Henriette Van Galen, Carmine Mastro Giacoma, and Peter King. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember the recently departed and pray for those who grieve their loss, especially for Noreen Rue, Leslie Hansen, Pat Hobbs, Helena Fontenelle, and Shirley Smith. We also remember those whose anniversaries fall this week: June Salter, Annie Nibb, Patricia Letchford, George Osborne, Brian Robinson, Philip Wells, Ian Fusdale, Daisy Samford, Frank Stanley, Anne Sage, Millicent Pusney, and Philip Wells. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, whose blessed Son did suffer for all mankind, grant to us that rightly observing this holy season, we may learn to know you better, to love you more, and to serve you with a more perfect will.
through the same Lord Jesus Christ our Lord. So, dear Lord, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand if you're able for the peace. Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ Jesus, we've been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood. For he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. It is often one of the sign of Christ's peace. Thank you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to set before you. Fruit of the vine, work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you to be our, in your great goodness, to be our Savior. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, the source of all holiness. Grant that, by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, looking for his coming in glory, We celebrate this memorial of our redemption as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people. Gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share one bread. Faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same, Lord. Nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and drink his blood, so the bodies may be made by his body, our souls washed in most precious blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant, and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the mind to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Jesus Christ, crucified, draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Notices. First, a huge thank you to our readers, the Dramatised Passion, and to Alison, who organised and prepared for our dramatised reading of the Passion this morning, to prepare us for Holy Week. Aha, some palms, I think. Let's see what's coming up. So on Tuesday, as you see, at 7 o'clock, there's the agape meal. Remember, agape in Greek means love, charity. So that's at 7 o'clock on Tuesday. If you'd like to come to that, please let Judy, who's there, know today, because she needs the numbers so we know how much food to get. So that's the meal on Tuesday evening. There's also, in the distance, the coronation street party lunch. So people are beginning to get ready beyond Easter for the next great event, the coronation. So on Sunday the 7th of May, after the 10 o'clock service, the usual service on a Sunday morning, there will be a street party lunch here. And if you want to come to that, sign up with Alison, church warden. Other things, just to say, the electoral roll is now open for any new people who'd like to be included. So ask the church wardens for a form if you're not on the electoral roll. And just to go through, most importantly, the services in this Holy Week. So we have Stations of the Cross at 8 o'clock tomorrow for people who are at work during the day. And then on Tuesday at 4 o'clock, Stations of the Cross, and also the Agape meal in the evening at 7. And then Stations of the Cross on Wednesday at 4 o'clock. Thursday, there is no Holy Communion in the morning because the priests go to St. Paul's Cathedral to be with the bishop for the Maundy Thursday Eucharist there. But there is there's the Maundy Thursday Eucharist with the washing of feet in the evening, followed by the watch. So it's demanding, and it's difficult, as I said in the sermon, or the brief sermonette, to not to turn away or to lose attention. But I think the church does make these services most dramatic. They involve the senses. So the vicar will touch you, if you want him to, on Thursday, your feet, at least, and wash them. That's something that doesn't usually happen in the service. And you've got the drama that you're taken up into. Remember, these services came from Jerusalem, so people would reenact what happened around the time it happened in Jerusalem, where it happened. So you've got the Via Dolorosa. Maybe some of you have been there. So they reenact it. If you go to the Via Dolorosa, sometimes you see people carrying a cross or making the Station of the Cross in that place where it happened. And they brought it back. Pilgrims brought it back. And so through time and space, it comes to us in Holy Week. Jerusalem comes to us. And it's reenacted. It's dramatic. It involves our senses. So on Maundy Thursday, we have our feet washed. And we can watch with Jesus at the altar of repose afterwards, remembering the agony in the Garden of Gethsemane when the disciples fell asleep and left him alone. And then, of course, next day, Good Friday, at 12 noon, the Good Friday liturgy, where you see the priests prostrate themselves in front of the cross. So the drama, and then the Paschal Vigil and First Eucharist of Easter with the Paschal candle. So we process into the church from the west door in the dark, and the priest sings the light of Christ in the darkness. Now the light comes into the darkness. So the drama, you know, it's demanding, but it's dramatic, involves our senses, engages us. in these services of Good Friday and of Holy Week. So you've got the Paschal Vigil at 9 o'clock on Saturday, and then the Easter morning Eucharist with the renewal of baptismal vows next Sunday for Easter Sunday. So that's what's coming up this Holy Week. So let's see what the children have done with some palms, I think. So what they've got to say. Okay. William, have you got any comments, first of all? He gave it a little kiss. Hold it up, yeah. So what is this, Bailey? What
a
is
palm.
This? A palm. Oh, that's pretty good. You made that out of what? Newspaper?
Yes.
What do you think about palms?
They're nice.
Yes.
Oh.
What's on those leaves?
Jesus, and we put Jesus' name in the middle because Jesus was in the middle of the crowd.
Yes, and you would have been there maybe waving your palm branch or maybe feeding a donkey, who knows? Any final comments, William? Okay, thank you very much. There we are. So we sing our final hymn, 368. Peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.